Penguin Random House Audio presents The Immortalists by Chloe Benjamin. Read for you by Maggie Hoffman. Prologue. The Woman on Hester Street. 1969. Varya. Varya is 13. New to her are 3 more inches of height and the dark patch of fur between her legs. Her breasts are palm-sized, her nipples pink dimes. Her hair is waist-length and medium brown, not the black of her brother Daniel's or Simon's lemon curls, not Clara's glint of bronze. In the morning, she plaits it in 2 French braids. She likes the way they whisk her waist, like horses' tails. Her tiny nose is no one's, or so she thinks. By 20, it will have risen to assume its full hawkish majesty, her mother's nose. But not yet. They wind through the neighborhood, all 4 of them. Varya, the eldest, Daniel, 11, Clara, 9, and Simon, 7. Daniel leads the way, taking them down Clinton to Delancey, turning left at Forsyth. They walk the perimeter of Sarah D. Roosevelt Park, keeping to the shade beneath the trees. At night, the park turns rowdy, but on this Tuesday morning, there are only a few clumps of young people sleeping off the previous weekend's protests, their cheeks pressed to the grass. At Hester, the siblings become quiet. Here, they must pass Gold's Tailor and Dressmaking, which their father owns, and, though it is not likely he'll see them, Saul works with total absorption, as if what he is sewing is not the hem of a men's pant leg, but the fabric of the universe. He is still a threat to the magic of this muggy July day and its precarious, trembling object, which they have come to Hester Street to find. Though Simon is the youngest, he's quick. He wears a pair of handed-down jean shorts from Daniel, which fit Daniel at the same age, but sag around Simon's narrow waist. In one hand, he carries a drawstring bag made of a chinoiserie fabric. Inside, dollar bills rustle and coins shimmy their tin music. "Where is this place?" he asks. "I think it's right here," Daniel says. They look up at the old building, at the zigzag of the fire escapes and the dark rectangular windows of the 5th floor, where the person they have come to see is said to reside. "How do we get inside?" Varya asks. It looks remarkably like their apartment building, except that it's cream instead of brown, with 5 floors instead of 7. "I guess we ring the buzzer," Daniel says. "The buzzer for the 5th floor.
"Yeah," says Clara. "But which number?"
Daniel pulls a crumpled receipt out of his back pocket. When he looks up, his face is pink. "I'm not sure."
"Daniel!"
Varya leans against the wall of the building and flaps a hand in front of her face. It's nearly 90 degrees, hot enough for her hairline to itch with sweat and her skirt to stick to her thighs. "Wait," Daniel says. "Let me think for a second." Simon sits down on the asphalt. The drawstring purse sags like a jellyfish between his legs. Clara pulls a piece of taffy from her pocket. Before she can unwrap it, the door to the building opens and a young man walks out. He wears purple-tinged glasses and an unbuttoned paisley shirt. He nods at the Golds. "You want in?"
"Yes," says Daniel. "We do."
And he is scrambling to his feet as the others follow him. He is walking inside and thanking the man with the purple glasses before the door shuts. Daniel, their fearless, half-inept leader, whose idea this was. He heard 2 boys talking last week while in line for the kosher Chinese at Schmolka Bernstein's, where he intended to get one of the warm egg custard tarts he loves to eat, even in the heat. The line was long, the fans whirring at top speed, so he had to lean forward to listen to the boys and what they said about the woman who had taken up temporary residence at the top of a building on Hester Street. As he walked back to 72 Clinton, Daniel's heart skipped in his chest. In the bedroom, Clara and Simon were playing chutes and ladders on the floor while Varya read a book in her top bunk. Zoya, the black and white cat, lay on the radiator in a square frame of sun. Daniel laid it out for them, his plan.
I don't understand.
Faria propped a dirty foot up on the ceiling.
What exactly does this woman do?
I told you. Daniel was hyper, impatient. She has powers.
Like what?
Asked Clara, moving her game piece. She'd spent the first part of the summer teaching herself Houdini's rubber band card trick, with limited success.
What I heard, said Daniel, is she can tell fortunes, what'll happen in your life, whether you'll have a good one or a bad one, and there's something else.
He braced his hands in the doorframe and leaned in.
She can say when you'll die.
Clara looked up.
That's ridiculous, said Varya.
Nobody can say that.
And what if they could?
Asked Daniel.
Then I wouldn't want to know.
Why not?
Because.
Varya put her book down and sat up, swinging her legs over the side of the bunk.
What if it's bad news? What if she says you'll die before you're even a grown-up?
Then it'd be better to know, said Daniel, so you could get everything done before.
There was a beat of silence. Then Simon began to laugh, his bird's body fluttering. Daniel's face deepened in color.
I'm serious, he said. I'm going. I can't take another day in this apartment. I refuse. So who the hell is coming with me?
Perhaps nothing would have happened were it not the pit of summer, with a month and a half of humid boredom behind them and a month and a half ahead. There is no air conditioning in the apartment, and this year, the summer of 1969, it seems something is happening to everyone but them. People are getting wasted at Woodstock and singing Pinball Wizard and watching Midnight Cowboy, which none of the Gold children are allowed to see. There's rioting outside Stonewall, ramming the doors with uprooted parking meters, smashing windows and jukeboxes. They're being murdered in the most gruesome way imaginable, with chemical explosives and guns that can fire 550 bullets in succession, their faces transmitted with horrifying immediacy to the television in the Gold's kitchen.
They're walking on the motherfucking moon, said Daniel,
who had begun to use this sort of language, but only at a safe remove from their mother. James Earl Ray is sentenced, and so is Sirhan Sirhan, and all the while, the Golds play jacks or darts or rescue Zoya from an open pipe behind the oven, which she seems convinced is her rightful home. But something else created the atmosphere required for this pilgrimage. They are siblings this summer, in a way they will never be again. Next year, Varya will go to the Catskills with her friend, Aviva. Daniel will be immersed in the private rituals of the neighborhood boys, leaving Clara and Simon to their own devices. In 1969, though, they are still a unit, yoked, as if it isn't possible to be anything but.
I'll do it, said Clara.
Me too,
Simon said.
So how do we get an appointment with her?
Asked Varya, who knew by 13 that nothing comes for free.
What does she charge?
Daniel frowned.
I'll find out.
So this is how it started, as a secret, a challenge, a fire escape they used to dodge the hulking mass of their mother, who demanded that they hang laundry or get the goddamn cat out of the stovepipe whenever she found them lounging in the bunk room. The Gold children asked around. The owner of a magic shop in Chinatown had heard of the woman on Hester Street. She was a nomad, he told Clara, traveling around the country, doing her work. Before Clara left, the owner held up one finger, disappeared into a back aisle, and returned with a large square tome called The Book of Divination. Its cover showed 12 open eyes surrounded by symbols. Clara paid 65 cents and hugged it on the walk home. Some of the other residents at 72 Clinton Street knew of the woman, too. Mrs. Blumenstein had met her in the 50s at a fabulous party, she told Simon. She let her schnauzer out on the front stoop, where Simon sat, and where the dog promptly produced a pellet-sized turd, of which Mrs. Blumenstein did not dispose.
She read my palm,
She said I would have a very long life, Mrs. Blumenstein said, leaning forward for emphasis. Simon held his breath. Mrs. Blumenstein's own breath smelled stale, as if she were exhaling the same.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.